William Collins and Argo present Hamlet, written by William Shakespeare. Performed by the Marlowe Dramatic Society and professional players.
Answer me! Stand and unfold yourself!
Long live the king!
Bernardo!
He!
You come most carefully upon your hour.
'Tis now struck 12. Get thee to bed, Francisco.
For this relief, much thanks. 'Tis bitter cold, and I am sick at heart.
Have you had quiet guard?
Not a mouse stirring.
Well, good night. If you do meet Horatio and Marcellus, the rivals of my watch, bid them make haste.
I think I hear them. Stand, ho, who's there?
Friends to this ground.
And liegemen to the Dane.
Give you good night.
Oh, farewell, honest soldier. Who hath relieved you?
Bernardo hath my place. Give you good night.
Hola, Bernardo.
Say, what, is Horatio there?
A piece of him.
Welcome, Horatio. Welcome, good Marcellus.
What, has this thing appeared again tonight?
I have seen nothing.
Horatio says 'tis but our fantasy, and will not let belief take hold of him, touching this dreaded sight, twice seen of us. Therefore I have entreated him along with us to watch the minutes of this night, that if again this apparition come, he may approve our eyes and speak to it.
Tush, tush, 'twill not appear.
Sit down a while, and let us once again assail your ears that are so fortified against our story what we have tonight seen.
Well, sit we down, and let us hear Bernardo speak of this.
Last night of all, when yon same star that's westward from the pole had made his course to illume that part of heaven where now it burns, Marcellus and myself, the bell then beating one with...
Peace, break thee off! Look where it comes again.
The same figure like the king that's dead.
Thou art a scholar, speak to it, Horatio.
Looks it not like the king? Mark it, Horatio.
Most like. It harrows me with fear and wonder.
It would be spoke to.
Question it, Horatio.
What art thou that usurp'st this time of night, together with that fair and warlike form in which the majesty of buried Denmark did sometimes march? By heaven I charge thee, speak.
It is offended.
See, it stalks away.
Stay, speak. Speak. I charge thee, speak.
'Tis gone and will not answer.
How now, Horatio? You tremble and look pale. Is not this something more than fantasy? What think you want?
Before my God, I might not this believe without the sensible and true avouch of mine own eyes.
Is it not like the king?
As thou art thyself. Such was the very armor he had on when he the ambitious Norway combated. So frowned he once, when in an angry parle he smote the sledded poleaxe on the ice. 'Tis strange.
Thus, twice before, and jump at this dead hour, with martial stalk hath he gone by our watch.
In what particular thought to work I know not. But in the gross and scope of mine opinion, this bodes some strange eruption to our state.
Good, now sit down, and tell me, he that knows, why this same strict and most observant watch so nightly toils the subject of the land? And why such daily cast of brazen cannon and foreign mart for implements of war? Why such impressive shipwrights, whose sore task does not divide the Sunday from the week? What might be toward that this sweaty haste doth make the night joint laborer with the day? Who is that can inform me?
That can I. At least the whisper goes so. Our last king, whose image even but now appeared to us, was, as you know, by 14 brass of Norway, thereto pricked on by a most emulate pride, dared to the combat, in which our valiant Hamlet, for so this side of our known world esteemed him, did slay this 14 brass, who by a sealed compact, well ratified by law and heraldry, did forfeit with his life all those his lands which he stood seized of to the conqueror. Against the which, a moiety competent was gauged by our king, which had returned to the inheritance of 14 brass had he been vanquisher, as by the same comart and carriage of the article designed, his fell to Hamlet. Now, sir, young 14 brass, of unimproved metal, hot and full, hath in the skirts of Norway here and there sharked up a list of lawless resolutes for food and diet to some enterprise that hath a stomach in't, which is no other as it doth well appear unto our state, but to recover of us by strong hand and terms compulsatory those foresaid lands so by his father lost. And this, I take it, is the main motive of our preparations, the source of this our watch, and the chief head of this post-haste and roamage in the land.
I think it be no other but e'en so. Well may it sort that this portentous figure comes armed through our watch so like the king that was and is the question of these wars.
A mote it is to trouble the mind's eye. In the most high and palmy state of Rome, a little ere the mightiest Julius fell, the grave stood tenantless, and the sheeted dead did squeak and gibber in the Roman streets. And even the like precursor of fierce events, as harbingers preceding still the fates, and prologue to the omen coming on, have heaven and earth together demonstrated unto our climatures and countrymen, as stars with trains of fire, and dews of blood, disasters in the sun, and the moist star, upon whose influence Neptune's empire stands, were sick almost to doomsday with eclipse. But soft, behold, lo, when it comes again, I'll cross it though it blast me.
Stay, illusion! If thou hast any sound or use of voice, speak to me. If there be any good thing to be done that may to thee do ease and grace to me, speak to me. If thou art privy to thy country's fate, which happily foreknowing may avoid, oh, speak. Or if thou hast abhorred in thy life extorted treasure in the womb of earth, for which they say you spirits oft walk in death, speak of it, stay and speak.
Stop it, Marcellus!
Shall I strike at it with my partisan?
Do if it will not stand!
Tis here!
Tis gone. We do it wrong, being so majestical, to offer it the show of violence, for it is as the air invulnerable, and our vain blows malicious mockery.
It was about to speak when the cock crew.
And then it started like a guilty thing upon a fearful summons. I have heard the cock that is the trumpet to the morn doth with his lofty and shrill-sounding throat awake the god of day, and at his warning, whether in sea or fire, in earth or air, the extravagant and erring spirit hies to his confine. And of the truth herein this present object made probation.
It faded on the crowing of the cock. Some say that ever against that season comes wherein our Saviour's birth is celebrated, this bird of dawning singeth all night long. And then they say no spirit dare stir abroad. The nights are wholesome, then no planets strike, no fairy takes, nor witch hath power to charm. So hallowed and so gracious is that time.
So have I heard, and do in part believe it. But look, the morn in russet mantle clad walks o'er the dew of yon high eastward hill. Break we our watch up, and by my advice let us impart what we have seen tonight unto young Hamlet. For upon my life this spirit dumb to us will speak to him. Do you consent we shall acquaint him with it, as needful in our loves, fitting our duty?
Let's do it, I pray, and I this morning know where we shall find him most convenient.
Though yet of Hamlet, our dear brother's death, the memory be green, and that it us befitted to bear our hearts in grief, and our whole kingdom to be contracted in one brow of woe, yet so far hath discretion fought with nature, that we with wisest sorrow think on him, together with remembrance of ourselves. Therefore, our sometime sister, now our queen, the imperial jointress to this warlike state, have we, as 'twere, with a defeated joy, with an auspicious and a dropping eye, with mirth in funeral and with dirge in marriage, in equal scale weighing delight and dole, taken to wife. Nor have we herein barred your better wisdoms, which have freely gone with this affair along. for all our thanks. Now follows that you know. Young Fortinbras, holding a weak supposal of our worth, or thinking by our late dear brother's death our state to be disjoint and out of frame, colleagued with this dream of his advantage, he hath not failed to pester us with message, importing the surrender of those lands lost by his father with all bands of law to our most valiant brother. So much for him. Now for ourself, and for this time of meeting, thus much the business is. We have here writ to Norway, uncle of young Fortinbras, who, impotent and bedrid, scarcely hears of this his nephew's purpose, to suppress his further gate herein, in that the levies, the lists, and full proportions are all made out of his subject. And we here dispatch you, good Cornelius, and you, Voltimand, for bearers of this greeting to old Norway, giving you no further personal power to business with the king more than the scope of these dilated articles allow. Farewell, and let your haste commend your duty.
In that and all things will we show our duty.
We doubted nothing. Heartily, farewell. And now, Laertes, what's the news with you? You told us of some suit. What is Laertes? You cannot speak of reason to the Dane and lose your voice. What wouldst thou beg, Laertes, that shall not be my offer, not thy asking? The head is not more native to the heart, the hand more instrumental to the mouth, than is the throne of Denmark to thy father. What wouldst thou have, Laertes?
My dread lord, your leave and favour to return to France, from whence, though willingly, I came to Denmark to show my duty in your coronation. Yet now I must confess that duty done, my thoughts and wishes bend again toward France, and bow them to your gracious leave and pardon.
Have you your father's leave? What says Polonius?
He hath, my lord, wrung from me my slow leave by labours and petition, and at last, upon his will, I seal my hard consent. I do beseech you give him leave to go.
Take thy fair hour, Laertes. Time be thine, and thy best graces spend it at thy will. Now, my cousin Hamlet, and my son.
A little more than kin, and less than kind.
How is it that the clouds still hang on you?
Not so, my lord. I am too much in the sun.
Good Hamlet, cast thy nighted colour off, and let thine eye look like a friend on Denmark. Do not forever with thy veiled lids seek for thy noble father in the dust. Thou know'st 'tis common all that lives must die, passing through nature to eternity.
Aye, madam, it is common.
If it be, why seems it so particular with thee?
Seems, madam? Nay, it is. I know not seems. 'Tis not alone my inky cloak, good mother, nor customary suits of solemn black, nor windy suspiration of forced breath, no, nor the fruitful river in the eye, nor the dejected haviour of the visage, together with all forms, modes, shapes of grief that can denote me truly. These indeed seem, for they are actions that a man might play. But I have that within which passes show. These but the trappings and the suits of woe.
'Tis sweet and commendable in your nature, Hamlet, to give these mourning duties to your father. But you must know your father lost a father. That father lost, lost his, and the survivor bound in filial obligation for some term to do obsequious sorrow. But to persevere in obstinate condolement is a course of impious stubbornness. 'Tis unmanly grief. It shows a will most incorrect to heaven, a heart unfortified, a mind impatient, an understanding simple and unschooled. For what we know must be, and is as common as any the most vulgar thing to sense, why should we, in our peevish opposition, take it to heart? Fie! 'Tis a fault to heaven, a fault against the dead, a fault to nature, to reason most absurd, whose common theme is death of fathers, and who still hath cried from the first course till he that died today, this must be so. We pray you, Throw to earth this unprevailing woe, and think of us as of a father. For let the world take note, you are the most immediate to our throne, and with no less nobility of love than that which dearest father bears his son, do I impart toward you. Your intent in going back to school in Wittenberg, it is most retrograde to our desire. And we beseech you, bend you to remain here in the cheer and comfort of our eye. Our chiefest courtier, cousin and our son.
Let not thy mother lose her prayers, Hamlet. I pray thee stay with us. Go not to Wittenberg.
I shall in all my best obey you, madam.
Why, 'tis a loving and a fair reply. Be as ourself in Denmark. Madam.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.